God, if you need a miracle. Lord, I thank you that miracles are your specialty. You love doing stuff that, when it happens, people say, it must have been God. I just heard the Lord say, that's true. I do love doing things that when it happens, people say, that must have been God. So Lord, right now, for everyone's hand is open, let heaven invade their lives. Lord, because you are in the business of meeting our needs according to our faith, let faith rise.
Yeah.
Let faith rise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for joy unspeakable and full of glory. Thank you, Lord, that you're teaching us to live life out of the rest and the peace of your presence. You're teaching us to respond to your voice. You're teaching us to walk with you, talk with you. You're teaching us, Lord, to let go sometimes, just let God. And you're teaching us when we need to press in and speak it forth until it happens. You're just teaching us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're teaching. I'm in awe because, you know, I'm thinking back 7 years ago to when we started this church with not much understanding and just a passion to go to war against the darkness, go to war against the enemy, and see God do some stuff. Everyone say stuff.
Stuff,
it gets fun. Church gets fun when God's doing stuff.
Amen.
You know, it's just kind of ho-da-hum, regular, predictable. Then it kind of gets boring fast, but when God's doing stuff in our lives, that's exciting. And so that's always been the trajectory of this church, is to just follow Jesus with passion and to raise up disciples. Follow him to the ends of the earth. And that's what we're doing. And I just have this feeling that we're actually just beginning. We're just starting this church now. And I know it sounds kind of weird because we're sitting here in this, you know, pretty small space. It kind of feels, wow, there's a lot of people here. But I think that we're just starting, and I'm so thankful for what God has done, you know, because I'm so thankful for my relationship with Mark Fossey. I'm so thankful that he gave me his car. I take care of it, my baby now. I'm thankful that, you know, God rescued Dave Douglas. What, 9 years ago now, wasn't it? Thankful that God's brought so many of us out of darkness and into his light. I just felt to say that, man. I think we're just getting started. We're just getting the pulse for what God wants to do. And so we're on course of recovering the reality that it's gonna be wild. Everyone say wild.
Wild.
Say that again, wild.
Wild.
Think, what do you think of? When I think of wild, I think of a wild stallion, you know, prancing through the fields. I think of, you know, ultimate fighting. I think of, I don't know, what do you think of?
Bears.
Bears? What do you think of when I say wild?
Jungle.
Jungles. It's intense. You think of Pastor Josh. It's gonna be wild. It's gonna be great. It's gonna be full of God. And this is how God wants, what He wants us to put our expectancy in it. It's gonna be wild, great, full of God. Full of His glory. We gotta get a move on here. Holy smokes. Just a few quick announcements that Mark didn't give. Just, we do have a... Last Friday night... Thank you, Austin. I'm gonna just pray real quick. Lord... I pray right now, under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, that every person in this room would be strengthened and edified and steadfied in their walk with you, God. And that identity, who we are in Christ and who we are as sons and daughters of God would flood our beings, and revelation knowledge would be our portion tonight. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Help me, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Last week I spoke a message. We're doing a series right now called IDIQ. And the premise, the thesis of the series is that the stronger and the more understanding you get, and the more intellectual you become about who you are in Christ, the stronger you get.
Amen.
And it's actually true. You know, for the last 13 years, every single year, I look back and say, wow, I am more secure in my identity in Christ. And many times God brought me to the school of ministry when I was 19, and He used that, you know, to really strengthen me. And God, when I started this church, I was like, oh God, what the heck am I doing? This is crazy, you know? And He strengthened my identity more. And every time I read my Bible and push in, and He's brought people into my life, like Mark Fossey, and Carly, and Mike Fleischer, and Carla, who become just very close to me and spoken identity into my life. And I keep getting stronger. And the more that we grasp who we are in Christ, the more we stand up and go, I'm not taking stuff from anybody.
You got that right.
I'm not going to take junk from the devil. I'm not going to take junk from my mama. I'm not going to take junk from my brothers. I'm not going to take junk from the world. Do you know who I am?
Devil, stay behind me. Behind me.
That's what I say.
Behind me.
You know? So the Bible says stuff like, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. And, you know, Paul had a revelation, that's in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, that Satan's actually, where he belongs, is right here.
That's right. Right. That's right.
That's where he, that's his destiny. Mm-hmm. Under my feet.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so, Jesus said stuff like, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So when you grasp truth about who you are in Christ, you get strong by default. You start obeying God because it's your nature to obey God as His sons and His daughters. You start ripping it up for Jesus, and you don't even mean to. It just flows out of you. You guys with me tonight?
Yeah.
Praise you.
I'm gonna sucker punch someone in the spirit tonight, and you're gonna get this. You're gonna get this.
Hold me back.
In the spirit.
Hold me back.
Um. Last week we did part two. We did grab it, reconciled and righteous. And basically, I was going to do 3 points, and I never got to point three, so I'm going to do point three today. And, oh, did someone just shut the light off? Let's turn that on. Can you guys see your Bibles?
Yeah.
I don't have a Bible.
Let's leave that everything on.
And I talked
about how revelation comes to us who are hungry. Revelation comes to us who hunger and thirst after it. That was point number one. And how God will often, he'll withhold revelation from us. And he'll withhold anointing from us and power from us because we're not ready to walk in it. So identity comes as we walk with God and as we pursue him and as we get to know him. You know, someone with an experience outweighs someone with information.
Yeah.
Do you guys know that?
Mm-hmm.
Someone with an experience will always who they are and what they're going to say is going to outweigh, because they'll fight to the death over something that they have experienced is real.
It's action, reaction.
But if you just have heard something, then it's not as tangible to you. We need to experience it, so we hunger after it, we grab it. The second point was reconciled and righteous, and he's talked about how God has reconciled us to himself, and that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Mm-hmm. That we're not sinners saved by grace. Let me say it again. You're not a sinner saved by grace. Amen. You are actually the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
Yeah. Amen.
When he looks at you, all he sees is, perfect. What about all my sin? That sin is not a part of you.
Yeah.
You may have some pets. You may have some stuff in your life that's kicking your butt, but it's not who you are anymore. Because Christ has separated. That's why you're going through hell right now. Because you're separated from your sin, but you're trying to hold on to it. It's an interesting thing when you try to hold on to darkness and you're actually light. All this conflict is going on inside of you. All this craziness is going on inside of you because you're actually light in Christ Jesus. And when he looks at you, Mark Fosse, he sees righteous. When he looks at me, he sees my son, perfect. Because the blood of Jesus has cleansed us of all sin.
Yeah.
And so, but you're like, but I'm going through hell. Wait, maybe you have some misinformation about yourself, or maybe you got some pet sins that you haven't let go of yet. Whatever the case is, maybe there's a little bit of both. Sometimes there's a lot of both, But when we let go of stuff, we will feel more free.
Yeah.
Because there's not that conflict. Does that make sense to you guys?
All I can do is pray for my obstacle that I'm going through right now. He's slandered my name and slandered my name.
I can just pray for it.
That's all.
The Bible says, bless those who curse you.
Yes.
Pray for those who use you, who spitefully abuse you. Yeah. I lost track of thought. I had something I was just going to say. Paul said in Romans chapter 7 that if I sin, it is no longer I who sins, but the sin that dwells in me. That means that just because you're sinning, that doesn't mean that is you. It just means that there's something in your life that we need to repent of and get it out of your life. Mark, I was thinking about, Mark and I were getting a lot of guys who have struggled with pornography there's a program called Covenant Eyes. We're trying to get a lot of guys to this. It's been helping a lot of guys. Somebody had, somebody who was going to sign up for it and said, no, I'm not going to. They wrote Mark and said, I don't feel like this is going to help me. What Covenant Eyes does is just keeps you accountable, sends all the websites you've been to somebody so they can monitor it and just accountability partner. So, I'll get to phone up, Aaron and be like, Aaron, are you on these websites again? And he'll be, Aaron.
yes.
You know? whatever it is, you know?
Aaron.
YouTube.
Triple X, something, something, whatever. Kids in the room won't say whatever. It sends it, and somebody sent Mark, you know, an email, said, I'm not going to put it on my computer, because I don't feel like, you know, I feel like it's, what did they say? I feel like it's a performance or something like that, and I feel like it's just a faith issue.
They felt it was controlling.
Controlling. They felt it was controlling and felt like it was a faith. It's just, I just need more faith. But, I mean, faith is action.
Yes.
Faith is our response to God. God's saying, get free from this thing.
Faith is what gives us hope.
Faith is action. Do you know what? I think it takes faith to put covenant eyes on your computer. Mm-hmm. I think that's faith. I don't think it takes faith to do nothing. I think it takes faith to do something. And what I want to, the message I want to speak in point three was simply this. An increase in our understanding of who we are in Christ, it comes totally from God, and it'll come as we grab hold of it by faith. My job description as a pastor is to help each one of you and myself walk in faith. That's what I do for a living. That's the essence of being a pastor, because faith connects us to God. Yeah. You know, we could do a 25-part series on faith. There's a lot. The Bible talks a lot about faith. Mm-hmm. There's a depth to understanding faith. But in its essence, faith is simply this: our response to God.
It's like, what gives us
God
hope?
Says, come here, my son, Mike. Faith is coming. Faith is when we come. Now, does it take faith to hear God's voice? Yeah, he gives us that faith. He initializes everything. Everything comes from him. So he's the one who gives us the ability to hear from him. He gives us faith. But then it takes faith to respond to him. So faith, you know what it takes? It takes responsibility. As your faith grows, your response ability, connect those two. Just say response.
Response.
Okay, sorry. Just think about that for a second. Response dash ability. The ability of us to respond is the level of our faith.
Is it the same as action reaction?
No, I don't know. I don't know.
Well, for every action, there's a reaction. I think. I'm not challenging you. I'm just thinking about it.
It's a scientific statement that I learned in. But anyway. But ask me after my preach, because.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I'm not talking necessarily, you know.
No.
Physics 101 here.
No.
I'm talking about faith. Mm-hmm. Faith grows as our ability to respond to God grows. Who here has ever said no to something that God has asked them to do? I have. You know, God said, why don't you do that, so-and-so, and I'm like, and whether it was fear, or whether it was lack of trust, or whatever it was, I just, you know, and I've gone back to God and said, why didn't I do that? And he said, you're not there yet. So you're asking me, you just asked me to do something I'm not able to do? And he said, but you will be able to.
Yep. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
One man of God saw this, you know, t-shirt coming down from heaven, and it was like the size of a city block, and he was just like this little mouse. And God said, he said, God, what's that? He saw in a vision, and God said, that's your shirt. He said, Lord, it's huge. And God said, you'll grow into it. Mm. It's the size of a city block. You'll grow into it. Because as our faith, as our determination and our passion and our perseverance and our hope, and as we continue to respond to God, when he's speaking to us, our faith grows.
Yeah.
And this isn't responding with deeds only. It's responding when he says, come away with me. Come and rest with me. You know, some guys, they just work themselves into the ground. Mm-hmm. God's like, I want to refresh you. Mm-hmm. want to restore you. I know for me, I need to take a vacation this year. I don't take, I don't like taking vacations because I don't like leaving you guys.
Amen.
I'm like, I got to trust that God's going to take care of you if I'm not here to preach to you on Fridays. Like, God, are you able to do it? Like, think about it. Is God able to take care of his sheep?
Yes.
Yes.
What if I'm not there? Don't worry, I'll be there. You know, it's like trusting God. And so for me, it takes faith to go on. It takes me about 3 or 4 days when I'm at my cottage to disengage and to just rest. Because I'm so like determined to help people. I'm so determined to introduce people to Jesus. And I'm so determined to encourage everybody that it just takes me 3 or 4 days just to be like, wait. But that's just what God's called me to do. And I'll get better at it. My faith will grow, and hopefully, you know, in 20 years when I go on vacation, I'll be able to disengage in 2 days or less. That'd be great. And I can disengage, but you know what I'm saying? Faith is our response. So growing in our identity, this is point three, and this is the message for tonight, is not one or the other. It's not like, well, is it all God or is it all me? It's both.
That's right.
My point is, it's both.
That's right, yeah.
Here God is, and he's saying, Ed, I love you. Come away with me. And Ed's like, here I come, Lord. Here I come.
That looks like Ed.
Prancing along. God says, this is, this is what I have for you.
Yep.
Yes, Lord. And it's a journey into knowing God.
Yep.
You know, one of the seasons I'm in, you know, right now, and I'm not preaching this because I haven't, I'm just in it, is where, you know, God is, out of my heart of submission to God, he's giving me a lot more choices now. It feels weird. He's like, what do you want to do? And I'm like, I don't know, tell me. Because I'm just so used to just obeying the command of the Lord. That's how I've gotten where I am. Just whatever you say, Lord, here I am. Use me.
Amen.
Here I am. You know, but built on submission to God. The Bible says, you know, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. You better believe it, man. When I pray, devils flee. If you pray, if you submit to God and resist the devil, he flees. And then I'm like, God, what do you want to do? It's my day off today, Lord. So what do you want to do? I just want to hang out with Carly all day. Sorry. I can't say sorry about a woman I love. Whatever. All right. Someone said, you talk about Carly all the time. And I'm like, oh, I don't even mean to. And then I just did it again. So I'm like, I'm going to try not to do that so much. And it's okay. Moving along. Whatever.
Why?
I don't
know. Do it. Getting married.
Really?
She likes it. Do it.
But you guys hear what I'm saying? Like, there's a level above obedience.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what's called? Likeness.
Likeness.
Where you're so intimate with God, you just know his heart.
Yeah.
And you're still obeying him, but you're walking in his very presence.
Yeah.
And it's just like stuff is changing all around you because you show up, he shows up, because he shows up, you show up. If you're just so intimate with Jesus, you're just like him. You're walking with him. And the Bible says in Psalm 32, God says, why are you like the horse that I need to put a bit in his mouth and drag him along? I want to guide you with my eye. Psalm 32 says, God just says, I want to guide you with my eye. Some of us are in a season right now where God's trying to get the bit in our mouth, and we're like, ah! we're like, don't put the bit in my mouth. I don't want to do it. You know, and he's trying to get us just to the place of submission to him. But when you're totally surrendered, he takes the bit out, and he's like, I'm gonna guide you with my heart.
Mm-hmm.
You spend time in my presence. We know each other. Call you friend, and you know my heart, I'm going to guide you with my eye. It's an intimate place with God. And that's where that's our portion. Amen?
Amen.
That's our portion as his people. To just walk with Jesus, guided by his eye. So it's both. That's my message tonight. I'm not done. Don't clap yet. Because I'm almost done. I want to read one scripture to make this like legal preach. And I want to say one more thing about God and his character. But it's not, you know, God comes down and yes, he shows us who we are. And then he's like, walk in it. Practice it. You know, I sometimes have these like flashes of pain that go through me because for years and years and years I wanted to be a professional baseball player. Mm. I dreamed about it as a kid. I salivated over playing for the Blue Jays.
Oh, the Blue Jays.
I alone, my passion for Blue Jays, I brought them to win the World Series in 1992 and 1993 myself. I watched every game, and I cheered, and I was like, I was so intense about it. And I actually believed that my passion caused them to win the World Series. I believe that. I'd be like, get a hit, come on, Roberto. Roberto Alomar, get a hit, come on, yeah. And I'd be like, I didn't even know it, but I'm prophesying over them. And I got pretty good. I made the, you know, out of like 200 kids or whatever, I made the rep ball team and Oshawa Legionnaires. And, you know, it's pretty intense, you know, even at age 11. It is. I mean, we travel all over Ontario, playing Toronto, we played Halliburton, we played everybody, we played all over the place. And it was good, and it just got too intense for me, and you know, it wasn't maybe my calling, but I still have glimpses of, man, what would it have been like? But there's my point. You know, I practiced every day to get to the point where I was. And faith, who you are in Christ, is something that we rehearse. Something we practice. Our response to God is something that we do. That's why we're here tonight. We're here tonight, and I want to read one scripture. If you got your Bible, we're gonna close with these thoughts and with this verse. Second Chronicles, chapter 5. This is so good. Solomon had just got done putting literally, probably, I don't know how much it was, but it was millions, if not hundreds of millions, even perhaps billions of dollars in his day, probably billions, into the temple of the Lord. And in chapter 5, verse 1, it says, thus all the work that Solomon did for the house of the Lord was finished. 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 1. And Solomon brought in the things that David his father had dedicated and stored the silver, the gold, and all the vessels in the treasuries of the house of God. Then Solomon assembled the elders. Look what Solomon's doing. He's preparing a place for God to dwell. He's not saying, oh God, you know, if you want to do this, then you know, you can just do it, and I'll just kind of hang out in the back. And Solomon had just got busy for years preparing a place for God. He said, then Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes, the leaders of the fathers' houses of all the people of Israel in Jerusalem, to bring up the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord out of the city of David, which is Zion. And all the men of Israel assembled before the king at the feast that is in the seventh month. And all the elders came, listen to this, and the Levites took up the Ark, and they brought up the Ark, the tent of meeting, and all the holy vessels that were in the tent, the Levitical priests brought them up. And King Solomon and all the congregation of Israel who had assembled before him were before the ark. Listen, look at sacrificing many sheep and oxen so that they could not be counted or numbered. That's a lot. The people of Israel are sitting there sacrificing so many sheep and oxen that they're like, we can't even number them. We can't put this number in the Bible because it's just, we don't even know. Sheep after 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 sheep after. You know what they're doing? They're practicing the glory of God. They're practicing worship. They're sacrificing their livelihood to Him. They're giving Him their lives. This is so massive. This is they're preparing their hearts. They're practicing worship. They're practicing the goodness of God. And they're saying, God, we trust you. So many sheep that could not be numbered or counted. Verse 7, then the priests brought the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to its place in the inner sanctuary of the house in the most holy place underneath the wings of the cherubim. The cherubim spread out their wings over the place of the Ark so that the cherubim made a covering above the Ark and its poles. And the poles were so long that the ends of the poles were seen from the holy place before the inner sanctuary, but they could not be seen from the outside. And there they are to this day. There was nothing in the ark except the two tables that Moses put there at Horeb, where the Lord made a covenant with the people of Israel when they came out of Egypt, and when the priests came out of the holy place. For all the priests who were present had consecrated themselves without regard to their divisions. And the Levitical singers, Asaph, Heman, and Judithan, their sons and kinsmen, arrayed in fine linen, with cymbals, with harps, with lyres, stood east of the altar with 120 priests who were trumpeters. This is what we do every Friday night. We come before God and we're like, you are awesome. You are worthy. And we don't bring sheep, thank God. We don't bring sheep and oxen and have to, you know, snap all these necks and cut all these heads off and burn all these sheep. I mean, it's kind of gross, but it's like, this is what they did before they had Jesus. They had to, somebody had to pay the sacrifice for sin, so they were slaughtering all these sheep. Now we have our great sacrifice, the Son of God, and so we gather around the Son of God. We gather around His finished work of the cross and His unlimited reserve of love and goodness and grace and passion and mercy. And we say, God, you are worthy of all of our praise. And we get as many instruments as we can up here that will sound good. And we worship and we praise and we dance and we sing. I'm telling you, some of us, we need to rip the roof off of our praise and off of our faith and off of our Christianity and be like David again. I challenge you in your bedroom to dance in your underwear before the Lord, because he loves it. He loves passion. Sometimes you just gotta rip the roof off of where you are and say, God, I'm gonna experience you again. I love you, God, and I wanna worship you. I wanna seek you until I find you. I am going after God. Yeah. It's just like, I don't know, I can't predict this for you. I can't tell you how to do it. For me, I just read my Bible and pray and put Delirious on, or play my guitar, or I just go for a run, or I just go for a drive, and I stand in the middle of the field and say, God, I love you. I love everything you do. I surrender my life to you, and boom, His presence just comes down on me, and I'm like, experience Him afresh again, because it's so awesome. This is what we do. This is what it means to live for the glory of God. This is what a wasted life. I want to waste my life on Jesus.
Yeah.
And a generation who does stuff like this will see the glory of God in their generation. And they'll see multitudes bowing to the knee. And they'll see Jesus parades. They'll see sinners bowing to the knee of Jesus in the streets. When we're not living for ourselves, we're not living for worldly pleasure, we're living for His glory. We're living for His glory. Solomon was living for His glory. He did all this, and look what happens. Verse 13, and it was the duty of the trumpeters and singers to make themselves heard in unison and praise. I need to say this truth to some people. Who need a fresh burst of faith. God calls us to worship Him. Mm-hmm. Because He's holy. Mm-hmm. Period.
Yep.
What do I get? whatever he gives you. Mm-hmm. What if I get nothing? Listen, if God didn't give me anything else other than salvation, it would be too much. He's already died on the cross for our sins. He's given us salvation. We get to be with him forever. And then in the benevolence and goodness of our Father's heart, he pours down so much blessing and favor and love and peace on us. And I'm going to finish this one. But this is good. Some of us just need to return to the basics, to seeking God with all of our hearts. And it was the duty of the trumpeters and singers to make themselves heard in unison in praise and thanksgiving to the Lord. And when the song was raised with trumpets and cymbals and other musical instruments in praise to the Lord, look it, they did all of this, and they're finally singing, and still nothing has happened. Because it's not about them. Why should I serve the Lord? Because he's worthy.
Yeah.
Why should I expend my energy and come and practice and be a part of a worship team? And why should I, get here early and usher? And why should I set up chairs and tear down chairs? And why should I do it week in, week out? And why should I, if God's called me to get involved on Sunday mornings, get up at 5:00 in the morning so I can go set up? And why should I? It is your duty, but it's not a duty out of you have to. It's a duty out of you get to. Because he is so holy. Because he is so worthy. Because he created you. And in his grace, he saved you. It is our holy, awesome duty to do everything we can to bring glory to his name. This is the us part. This is the us part. We just do everything that we possibly can to bring more glory to his holy name. Because he is so holy. Because he is so worthy. Because he is so awesome. And his love is everlasting. We do everything we can. We use all of our time, all of our money, all of our gifts and talents. We surrender our lives in dutiful submission to him because he is God. He's our Heavenly Father and he loves us. We submit our very, we surrender everything to him in response to him showing you his goodness. I can't force anyone to do it. You just gotta say, God, give my life. Give him everything. Verse 13, I want to read one more time. And it was the duty of the trumpeters and singers to make themselves heard in unison and praise. This is before anything happened. They're just like going nuts, praising God. Guitars, drums are going off, trumpets. Whoa, we worship you, God. Holy, holy, holy. Sacrificing blood spilling all over the place. Sheep are getting slaughtered. Oxen are getting slaughtered. More in number than can be counted. And we give you all the glory, God. And we give you all the praise. It's not about us. It's all about you. It's all about your great name. You've redeemed us as a people, a holy nation, a royal priesthood, a people that you've set apart for your own. You said that we will be your sons and daughters, and you will be our God. And we worship you, God, because you are totally awesome and because you are totally worthy. And they started singing this song. For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. For he is good, and his steadfast love endures forever. And they're singing it. The Bible says the house of the Lord was filled with a cloud. Oh, this is what I'm after. The house of the Lord was filled with a cloud. This is what happened at Bethel before revival broke out. Before Tom Skrell came, all this stuff happened 6 years ago. The house of the Lord, there was a tangible cloud. I wasn't at that meeting. I've never seen that cloud. I think the Lord, you know what God wants from Dunamis? I've just figured this out as of late, that we're not called to be Bethel Church in Sarnia or California. We're not called to be Elevation Church. God wants to do a new thing, and it will look different, and it will look crazy, and it will look full of God and wild, and it will look amazing. It's going to be me, and it's going to be you going after God figuring it out, trailblazing a path that's never been taken before. It's exciting. It's awesome. It's an opportunity of opportunities. If God's called you to this church, to be a part of a movement, to be a part of something that people call a cult, and they will call it a cult more as the glory of God comes. People aren't used to a cloud coming inside of their church and enveloping people, and this cloud came into the church so that the priests could not listen. The priests could not stand. Well, where is falling over in the Bible? The priests could not stand to minister before the cloud. And the glory of the Lord filled the house of God. And this is what we're after.
Yeah.
This, experiencing God, will release your identity more than anything I can teach you.
Yeah.
This experience, God loves me. I'm His son, and He's never going to leave me or forsake me. That will do more for you than a million sermons.
Yeah.
Will do more for me. If we prepare the way, God will show up.
Yeah.
If we invest, if we contribute our gifts and our talents and our passion, this is true. It's true. God will often call us to do things that we don't want to do. But He will never call us to do something we'll regret.
No.
Never. He'll call us to do things that are challenging. Your anointing and your sweet spot, the oil of God's presence comes when the olives are crushed. How do you make olive oil? You take olives and you crush them. How do you make a fragrance out of your life? You allow the Lord to do a work. You allow the cross to change you. And you change the trajectory of your life from serving yourself to serving His glory. That's what we're all about. We're serving the glory of God. Why are you getting up at 5 in the morning? It certainly can't be for Pastor Josh. But we would do anything for His glory. This is what I'm after. I'm after the cloud.
Yeah.
You're after the cloud of His glory? Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What are you going to do? Everything it takes. Only the disciples got to be with Jesus. And Jesus said, you can't follow me unless you deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. Salvation costs us nothing. It's a free gift. Totally free. You don't have to do anything, you don't have to jump through hoops. You just receive Him. Discipleship. This cloud will cost us. Who wants the cloud? The cloud of His presence. Father God, I thank You for tonight, and I thank You for Your presence and the ability that You give us to communicate and stir each other up. And God, maybe He'll send His cloud today. I don't know. He's just God. I don't. Depends how hungry we are, I think. I really do believe this. It's how hungry we are. You know, and I'm not putting a heavy on anybody. You just do what the Lord tells you to do. I'm going to be here from 11 p.m. till 4 a.m. tonight, seeking the Lord and praying an intercession for this city. And if you want to stay 10 minutes, an hour, 2 hours, or all 5, you're welcome to. It's going to start at 11 o'clock in here. We're going to seek the Lord. What's it going to look like? I don't know. We're just going to wait on Him, seek Him, and that's going to be good. But even right now, Lord, Lord, we just want to be after your glory, and we just want to be after your presence. Thank you, Lord, for a greater maturity. Thank you, Lord, for a greater understanding. Thank you, Lord, for greater passion. Thank you, Lord, just we want to give everything to you, but we're after the cloud of your presence. Lord Jesus, we're after the glory.
Yeah.
We want to bring you more glory. We want to bring you more honor. We want to bring you more praise. And so, Lord, I ask that you would do a work in our hearts. Dunamis Church is not about me, and it's not about us just having meetings. We are all about your glory. We are all about your praise and your honor. Lord, just give us perspective. I pray, Lord. Put a hunger. Put a hunger inside of us, Lord. For the glory. Yes, it's true, and I believe it. I'm living for you. I'm living for you. I'm gonna be a history maker in this land. I'm gonna be a speaker of truth to all mankind. I'm gonna run. I'm gonna run into your arms. Into your arms. Into your arms. That is not, don't take that weight upon yourself. This is a calling on God's church to be his voice. All of us together, every gift. Some of you guys, you're not called to preach. You're not, but you have gifts.
Yeah.
You've got stuff inside of you.
Yeah.
That as you invest in, the house of God and the people of God arise into a glorious crescendo of praise and worship. And God's like, I got my little cloud here, and I can't help but, oh, I want to hold back, but they're just going after me too strong, and I know it's going to wreck them. I know it's going to destroy them for anything that's not me, and it's going to stir up every devil in Sarnia, but I can't, just take it then, finally, woo, and it's glory, I'm telling you, it's going to happen.
Come on.
I'm gonna be, thank you, Lord. So, Lord, a history maker in this land. I pray that you would just wrap us.
Yeah.
Lord, and for those who I pray right now in this church, Lord, for a supernatural wisdom on every person with the sound of my voice. The devil would not be able to get in. The confusion would not be able to get in.
Yeah.
But Lord, that the rest and the peace of the Holy Spirit,
yeah,
the peace of Christ would guard every heart. And that I pray for every person in you that you would know your next step. My next step is not your next step. That you would have peace to know your next step.
Jesus, take the wheel.
You would have peace to know your next step. If you need to go back a little bit and say, God, you spoke to me back there. I'm back, I'm going to do that. And help us build your house in Jesus' name. If anyone in here doesn't know Jesus in a real way, and you would like to get to know him, I just want you to pray this prayer with me. You're saying, I need Jesus, I need to give my life to him, and it's time for me to say this with me. Lord Jesus, I give you my life. You've saved me. You've redeemed me. You've forgiven me of all my sin. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your grace. I receive your mercy. Now, Lord, separate me unto yourself. I say no.
I say no.
To sin, sickness. Satan.
Satan.
And I give myself to you, Jesus.
I give myself to you, Jesus.
Right. Now the war might begin. Of God fulfilling what you just prayed and asked him to do. Separate me from everything that's not of you. Holy smokes. You can say process into that. Thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing. Pray for wisdom for every person here in Jesus' name. And if you prayed that prayer and if that's a new, you know, you're walking with God in a new way or in a fresh way, we've got cards we'd love over at the black table in the corner. We'd love to fill you to fill them out so we can connect with you and have a great week. Let's build his kingdom and his glory this week. Amen?
Amen.
You guys are amazing. Be encouraged. Let's give Jesus a big hand clap. He's so good. Why don't you go ahead and try to hug five people before you leave tonight?